Hello. You're so pretty.
Nothing says adulthood like having to lint roll your furniture. Christo friends, welcome back to Opus Elenae, where we all have projects that have been in the works for years. We all do. It's not just me, right? You may remember the very first London hood I made on this channel. This pink pearl number that I sewed three... Oh my god, has it been 3 years? 3 years ago as part of an even older project, the Manuscript Challenge. For those of you who have slept in the last 3 years, the Manuscript Challenge was started by Maria Naiman in 2004. 2004, with the goal of choosing a manuscript image and recreating an outfit from it. Just for funsies, I'll link her original blog post in the description. Again, as a refresher, I chose this image from the Romance of Alexander, a manuscript dating from about 1340. I've already made the hood, so the next thing to tackle is the underdress. I actually spent ages looking for the perfect fabric for this dress. It's hard to see, but in a lot of digitized images, it appears to be kind of a gray mauve color that reads as a shot or changeable fabric to me. Shot fabric is an even weave fabric that consists of a warp of one color and a weft of another, and the interplay of angle and light creates this optical illusion of changing color. You often see it in silk, which gives a really dramatic effect, but I knew I wanted to make the outfit in linen because I'm contrary and because I still live in Texas. Shot linen is hard to find. It's out there, but generally it's quite expensive, and despite looking on the regular for literally years, I could never find just the right colors to create this shade. Eventually, I realized that perfect is the enemy of done and settled on this lavender and white yarn dyed linen. Yarn dyed fabric is woven with variegated thread, which also gives sort of a mottled look, but because that variegation occurs in both the warp and weft threads, it's not changeable in the same way as a shot fabric. So everyone, go grab your cuppa. Today, I'm drinking Passage by August Uncommon Teas. It is a black tea with chocolate and hazelnut, and it is so decadent with a bit of honey and a splash of cream. 100% recommend. Let's get into it. This project, I'm trying something new. A friend of mine, Hex, who is an absolute whiz with fiber arts, told me that they lay out their linen in long folds and soak it for a while before washing or drying, and that doing so will minimize wrinkles for the lifespan of the garment. So I'm gonna try it and see if it makes any difference. I tried a time lapse here to show how long the ironing takes, but I'm honestly not sold on it. And then my iron broke. Okay, got a little good news, bad news situation going on here. Bad news, I think I just blew a fuse in my iron. I'm gonna take this apart in just a second and double check that, and if that's the case, then the good news is that it's fixable and it's really easy to fix. I just have to wait until the fuse gets here, which is a tad bit annoying. Bad news, I didn't finish ironing all of my fabric before my iron went on the fritz. Good news, I only have like this much left, and it's only half of this. I think I can cut the cotehardie out of what I already have ironed, and I don't think it's going to be that big of a deal. And if it is, I will just break out my steamer and steam the rest of it. So I'm going to go and lay this out and see what I can do about cutting the cotehardie out of what I already have ironed. I'm going to go make sure that it is a fuse and that it's not actually broken, And if it is the fuse, then I'm going to order a new fuse. If it's the iron, I'm going to order a new iron. Because that's the kind of week I'm having.
First order of business. We do not f*** around with electricity. These things into a neat little bowl, and then we'll wait until the fuse gets here.
This linen is a lighter weight than I thought it would be when I ordered it. It's comparable with IL020 handkerchief weight linen from fabricstore.com, but I'm not that upset about it. I'm always looking for ways to cut down on my personal heat index, so I'm taking this opportunity to conduct an experiment. What is the lightest weight linen that I can make a supportive cotehardie from? Instead of using a medium weight linen as a lining, which was my first idea, I'm going to try to line it in some handkerchief weight that's left over from one of my chitons. And the perpetual disclaimer, I realize that my body may need less or different support from others, and my success or failure shouldn't be taken as predictive of other outcomes. One of the things I didn't get to do when initially ironing the fabric was the starch. Normally, when working with linen, especially lightweight linen, I will do one round of ironing just to dry the damp fabric and release wrinkles, and then do a second round adding starch to act as sizing. This keeps the linen from being all squidgy. Yes, it's a technical term, while I'm tracing and cutting the pieces. Structurally, this dress is much like the black cotehardie I made, with just a couple differences. I decided to go with a square neckline instead of a curved one. The straps angle in towards the center like later period cutting diagrams to prevent them from slipping off the shoulders and to create a nice little pocket for the pectoral muscle. The other difference is that this dress won't need an overlapping placket in front because it isn't going to have buttons. Since this is going to be the underdress in my manuscript outfit, I am going to spiral lace it up the front so it lays as flat as possible under the green overdress. To get rid of the placket, I'll just trace the front seam in a straight line.
Okay, it's been 2 days, and there is the old fuse and the new fuse. You can see how different they look.
Once all of the pieces are marked and cut, I can start sewing everything together. Since I cut the gores as part of the dress front and back to save on the number of seams I'm sewing, I will have to let the dress hang overnight before I can level the hem because 3 of the 4 skirt seams are on the bias. finishing the seam allowances on this dress by serging them. It's incredibly time effective, and I am still playing catch up as I put the new place in order. I think there tends to be a weird sort of smug satisfaction in the historical costuming community over handwork. It's okay to hand sew. It's okay to machine sew. It's okay to machine finish. As long as the article of clothing meets your production standards and makes you happy, it's all okay. After I've sewn the dress pieces together and the lining pieces together, I can pin them together right sides facing and sew them together along the front and neckline. How many times can I say together in one sentence? And don't worry about the arm size, I'll handle those later. The front-laced cotehardie is going to need a lace, and as usual, I broke out my handy-dandy lucet to make some cording. This lavender-gray color was really hard to match. I think I bought one of all of the light blue, lavender, and periwinkle embroidery threads that my local craft stores carried to see which worked best. Normally, I prefer a pearl cotton for luceting, but all of them were too dark, so I ended up using two skeins of a pale lilac DMC floss, which I will also use for the eyelets and buttonholes. Once I've got the laces started, I'll clip the corners and curves and trim the seam allowances along the neckline and turn the dress and lining right side out. A quick finger press to get the seams to lay nicely, and I can start making the eyelets. So many eyelets. I am marking my eyelet holes 3/4 of an inch apart. Any farther apart and the closure will lose stability and collapse downwards, creating all kinds of weird horizontal wrinkles. In order to get a properly spiral laced closure, the top two holes on one side and the bottom two holes on the other will be half that distance apart. This will result in the top and bottom eyelets being even and all of the ones in between being staggered in a zigzag. To sew the eyelets, I start by using a tapered awl to make a hole in the fabric. I'm trying to be careful to push the warp and weft threads apart instead of tearing them, since I don't want to compromise the integrity of the fabric. Then I will use 3 strands of embroidery floss to whip stitch around the edges of the eyelet to keep the hole open. You could use a blanket or buttonhole stitch, but most extant examples are just whip stitched.
Thank you.
taking a quick break halfway through sewing eyelets to reinforce the corners of the neckline with a buttonhole stitch. Then back to the eyelets. Only 27 more to go. Finished eyelets mean a quick try-on to make sure everything fits correctly. At this stage, it's still relatively easy to make fit changes in the torso, but once the sleeves are added, things get more complicated. Luckily, I'm happy with the fit and also the level of support I'm getting, so I can move on. Thank you to all of my current and continuing coffee members. Your support and the support of each of my members and the Croissant Army makes it easier to do what I do and to provide quality content for everyone. Thank you all so much. Stick around after this brief commercial break to see the sleeve construction and the reveal. Time for sleeves. I have a couple of changes I need to make before I can sew them up and insert them. First, the original picture has tight sleeves, but it doesn't seem to have the line of buttons from wrist to elbow that we see in later illuminations and funerary brasses. I'm going to need some kind of wrist closure to get a tight sleeve over my hand, though. I'll start by pinning the lower part of the sleeve together to see how small of an opening I can get away with. Because I'm going for a very airy, lightweight cotehardie, I'm not going to line the sleeves, which means I have to rethink the new, shorter button plackets. I've left a nice wide placket allowance, so I'm just going to fold it over twice and fell it into place, and that will give me 3 layers of fabric for button and buttonhole stabilization. Next up, sleeve insertion. I've marked the high point of each sleeve head, which will line up with the shoulder seam. Then I just pin around the sleeve, lining up the stitching lines. I actually need to adjust the sleeve pattern. There's a weird corner shape at the top of the sleeve seam that I need to trim off that I haven't yet. So as I'm pinning and sewing the sleeve, I'm just gonna round that corner off. I'm sewing the sleeve to the arm's eye of both the dress and lining at once, and then serging the seam. With a medium weight fabric, I would sew the sleeve to the fashion layer only and then turn the lining seam allowance under and fell it into place, but I want the extra stability of sewing it to 2 layers at once. For the wrist buttons, I'm using 4 small buttons left over from my gray cotehardie. Since there's so few, I'm just going to hand sew the buttonholes. It's quicker and easier than getting out the other machine. One of these days, I'm going to sit down and figure out how to sew buttonholes on the featherweight. I have tutorials saved and everything, but today is not that day. Once the buttonholes are finished, I'll mark the button placement with my trusty friction marker and sew the buttons into place. I probably should have used something stronger than embroidery floss, but that's what I had right there. I'm sure I won't regret that decision later. I just recently got a new tool from Wawak to help with the hem leveling. It's basically a stand with a weighted base and a little armature that can slide up and down. There's a reservoir filled with chalk, and when you squeeze the bulb, the chalk is blown out in a horizontal line. The armature only goes down to about 4 inches off the ground though, so I'm gonna try standing on a stool. The limiting factor is really the length of the hose at that point. It worked out fairly well. I think it might work better on a darker fabric than a lighter one, so I'll test that theory on the dark green overdress. The markings ended up being a few inches shorter than where I wanted the hem, so I added about 3.5 inches to each marking, smoothed the curve, and cut away the excess. Then all that's left to do is fell the hem, and I'm finished. Thank you for coming along with me today. It feels really good to tackle a project that's been on the books for a long, long, long time. Join me next time as I make the overdress and we figure out how to tackle tippets and, depending on how ambitious I actually get, possibly fur. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to like and subscribe, click the bell for notifications if you would like, and consider sharing this or any of my videos to the social media of your choice. If you're interested in finding me on the internets, I am at Opus Elenae everywhere, and those links, as well as the link to my coffee, will all be in the description box below. Until next time, be kind, do the work, continue supporting marginalized people, and keep creating. Woo!